Hey there, I'm Dave Hearn, and I'm the director of Kissimmee Park Observatory, and I've been using all kinds of telescopes for over 30 years. In this extra episode of Star Hopping, we're going to take a break from our normal routine and start our exploration of how to buy telescopes for beginners, kids or adults that are just getting started in astronomy and learning the night sky. There's a lot to talk about, so we're going to do this in two videos. Here in part one, we'll talk about the three variables you need to consider in selecting a telescope. And next week, in part two, we'll tell you where you can buy them and how much you can expect to pay. More about all this great stuff right after this. Stay tuned. Hey, hello, hi, and welcome to episode 7 of Star Hopping with Kissimmee Park Observatory. I'm Dave Hearn, and I'm totally jazzed to be your host. So this is our first star hopping extra. Occasionally we'll need to discuss some other interesting areas of amateur astronomy while we wait for the stars to rise a bit. This is one of those times, since in the recent episode we've been covering everything in the eastern sky until about the end of November. We'll get back to our deep sky targeting techniques in a couple weeks. So you want to pick out a telescope for a beginner amateur astronomer. Selecting the proper telescope is really an important decision to make because a great first scope can really kickstart a wonderful lifelong hobby. I get asked about this a lot because it can be a complicated decision, but no worries, we've got you covered. As we mentioned earlier, there are three main variables that you need to consider when buying a telescope. These variables will drive the features you'll need to consider in selecting a telescope that'll fit your needs. So here they are: the cost of the telescope, the size of the scope, and the type of the scope. Sounds pretty basic, right? These are all somewhat intertwined, and changing one variable can affect the other two, as we'll see. For most people, the first and foremost variable is probably cost. How much can you spend or are willing to spend for that first telescope? It's very possible to get a good quality entry-level telescope for under $200. A small scope like this is easy to transport and set up, easy to look through for even small kids, can be tucked away in a closet when it's not being used. This kind of purchase will allow you to look at craters on the moon and enjoy looking at the brighter planets like Jupiter and Saturn. But that's about it. You wouldn't be able to look at many deep sky objects or see too much detail. But for some people, the moon and planets are super exciting to find and examine and can be a great first scope if that's all you're really interested in. Raising the bar to spend $300 to $500 can get you a larger diameter scope. We'll explain why that's important when we get to the size variable. This price range will also get you some extra eyepieces, which will let you examine objects in more detail, like zooming in on a lunar crater or looking at the rings of Saturn or the moons of Jupiter. Plus, a larger scope will let you get into checking out some of the brighter star clusters and nebulae. Jumping up to the $1,000 level really makes a difference. Now you can look at really serious scopes that have either significantly larger size or have additional technology attached to them, like go-to systems that automatically move to find targets in the sky. But more about that a bit later. Now you're able to view the entire Messier list of objects and get started on the NGC list. Above $1,000, you get into serious amateur telescopes. As with any hobby, it's possible to spend tens of thousands of dollars on astronomy equipment, and some of us crazies actually do. So the next variable to discuss is size, meaning the aperture or diameter of the telescope. As I mentioned, the variable of cost goes up proportionally as you increase telescope size. As we astronomers say, there is no substitute for photons, and more photons of light are collected by a larger lens or mirror. The larger the aperture of the telescope, the brighter and clearer are its images. And when you have more light, you can increase magnification. There's an important thing to know about image magnification. I'm sure you've seen advertisements for little cheap 2-inch telescopes that claim, "See the planets at 1,000 power." Sure, you can use special eyepieces to push a poor little telescope to that level of magnification, but the image will be so dim and so blurry it'll be impossible to see anything. All telescopes, if they have quality optics that are aligned well, can usually be used at about 50 power per inch. So for a 10-inch reflecting telescope, you could use a maximum of about 500 power. That's a huge amount of magnification. Using this level of magnification on the moon would let you see craters within craters within craters. But similarly, that little 2-inch telescope could only go to about 100 power max and still give good images. So the bigger, the better as far as viewable images go. That's basically the main determination of image brightness in a telescope. There is a sickness amongst amateur astronomers known as aperture fever, which drives us to build or buy larger and larger telescopes so we can see fainter objects even better than before. So beware. It's easy to get caught up in this. I should know. The KPO reflector is an 18-inch scope that weighs 450 pounds. When I used to move it around before I built the observatory, I had a dedicated trailer for it. So as you can see, with a larger scope comes portability and storage issues. A 10-inch Dobsonian telescope can also be very heavy, and you would have a big problem getting it into a compact car. But the images you would see through it are bright, sharp, and clear. So the last variable to discuss is type, which means the optical design of the telescope and to some degree how the scope is mounted. There are three main types of optical designs and three types of mounts, which can be used in various combinations. The different combinations lend themselves to specific abilities and activities. So first, let's look at optical designs. The first and simplest is the basic refractor telescope, which has a lens or set of lenses at the front and an eyepiece at the rear. Refractors of any real quality tend to be expensive, and because of the difficulty of manufacturing, quality lenses of significant size tend to be smaller aperture, maxing out at about 6 inches or so in the most expensive models. Less aperture means less light, but refractors have much better image quality, so they produce very sharp images and are excellent for astrophotography. The sharpness tends to make up a bit for the dimmer images, if that makes sense. The second common optical design is the reflector telescope, which uses a concave primary mirror that collects light and bounces it back to a smaller flat secondary mirror set at a 45 degree angle. The light then reflects out through the side of the telescope tube to the eyepiece, which magnifies the image. The great advantage of reflectors is that they can be big, meaning the primary mirror can be large. Reflectors have less expensive design per inch, so you can get a lot more bang for your buck. So brighter images for less money. Sounds perfect, right? Sure, until you get aperture fever and your back starts to hurt on mornings after an observing session. So to combat this size issue, we go to the third optical configuration, a compound design. In this setup, the light comes in and bounces off a concave mirror, except the mirror has a hole in it that we'll understand in a second. The light bounces to a second mirror that is convex, so it further focuses the light, and then it reflects the light back through the hole that we saw earlier, and then into an eyepiece. This is called a folded light path design. Very often, a large corrector lens is mounted at the front of the scope to fix certain optical issues and seal the optical tube. This results in a much shorter tube, but still allows a large aperture. These types of scopes are generally more expensive than a plain reflector, but not so expensive as a quality refractor, and the tube lengths are much smaller. So that's about all we'll cover in this episode. Stay tuned to see part two here next week. We'll continue to bring you these astronomy tutorials every week. They'll be designed to help you find deep sky objects that are up in the sky at the time we post them to YouTube. If you found this video useful, please consider subscribing to our channel down there. Click the thumbs up, and please share it out to your friends who like looking at stars. Please feel free to leave any question or comment below, and we'll be sure to respond quickly. Also, please follow KPO on Facebook, where we post all of our astrophotos and keep everyone informed about upcoming astronomical events. We'd love to hear from you to discuss all this great stuff up in the sky. All the links to these places, including our website, kpobservatory.org, can be found below in the episode notes as well. And finally, if you feel this video provides you value and you'd like to see more, please consider supporting us on Patreon, where for a couple dollars per video, you can support our efforts and let us make even more great astronomy tutorials just like this one. Well, thanks again for watching, and we'll see you next time on Star Hopping with Kissimmee Park Observatory.